Sahih Al-Bukhari, Book 1, Revelation. Number 1, narrated by Umar bin Al-Khattab. I heard Allah's Messenger saying, "The reward of deeds depends upon the intentions, and every person will get the reward according to what he has intended. So, whoever emigrated for worldly benefits, or for a woman to marry, his emigration was for what he emigrated for." Number 2. Narrated by Aisha. Al-Harith bin Hisham asked Allah's Messenger, "O Allah's Messenger, how is the divine inspiration revealed to you?" Allah's Messenger replied, "Sometimes it is like the ringing of a bell. This form of inspiration is the hardest of all, and then this state passes off after I have grasped what is inspired. Sometimes the angel comes in the form of a man and talks to me, and I grasp whatever he says." Aisha added, "Verily I saw the Prophet being inspired divinely on a very cold day and noticed the sweat dropping from his forehead." Number 3. Narrated by Aisha. The commencement of the divine inspiration to Allah's Messenger was in the form of good dreams which came true like bright daylight, and then the love of seclusion was bestowed upon him. He used to go in seclusion in the cave of Hira, where he used to worship continuously for many days before his desire to see his family. He used to take with him the journey food for this day, and then come back to Khadija to take his food likewise again, till suddenly the truth descended upon him while he was in the cave of Hira. The angel came to him and asked him to read. The Prophet replied, "I do not know how to read." The Prophet added, "The angel caught me and pressed me so hard that I could not bear it any more. He then released me and again asked me to read, and I replied, 'I do not know how to read.' Thereupon he caught me again and pressed me a second time till I could not bear it any more. He then released me and again asked me to read, but again I replied, 'I do not know how to read.' Thereupon he caught me for the third time and pressed me, and then released me and said, 'Read in the name of your Lord who has created man from a clot. Read, and your Lord is the most generous.'" Then Allah's Messenger returned with the inspiration and with his heart beating severely. Then he went to Khadija bint Khuwaylid and said, "Cover me, cover me." They covered him till his fear was over, and after that he told her everything that had happened and said, "I fear that something may happen to me." Khadija replied, "Never. By Allah, Allah will never disgrace you. You keep good relations with your kith and kin, help the poor and the destitute, serve your guests generously, and assist the deserving calamity-afflicted ones." Khadija then accompanied him to her cousin, Waraka bin Nawful bin Asad bin Abdul Uzza, who, during the pre-Islamic period, became a Christian and used to write the writing with Hebrew letters. He would write from the Gospel in Hebrew as much as Allah wished him to write. He was an old man and had lost his eyesight. Khadija said to Waraka, "Listen to the story of your nephew, O my cousin." Waraka asked, "O my nephew, what have you seen?" Allah's Messenger described whatever he had seen. Waraka said, "This is the same one who keeps the secrets whom Allah had sent to Moses. I wish I were young and could live up to the time when people would turn you out." Allah's Messenger asked, "Will they drive me out?" Waraka replied in the affirmative and said, "Anyone who came with something similar to what you have brought was treated with hostility. And if I should remain alive till the day when you will be turned out, then I would support you strongly." But after a few days, Waraka died, and the divine inspiration was also paused for a while. Number 4. Narrated by Jabir bin Abdullah al-Ansari, reporting the speech of the Prophet. "While I was walking, all of a sudden I heard a voice from the sky. I looked up and saw the same angel who had visited me at the cave of Hira, sitting on a chair between the sky and the earth. I got afraid of him and came back home and said, 'Wrap me.' And then Allah revealed the following holy verses. 'O you who covers himself, arise and warn, magnify your Lord, purify your clothing, and steer clear of filth.'" After this, the revelation started coming strongly, frequently, and regularly. Number 5. Narrated by Sa'id bin Jubair. Ibn Abbas, in the explanation of the statement of Allah, "Move not your tongue concerning the Quran to make haste therewith," said, "Allah's Messenger used to bear the revelation with great trouble and used to move his lips quickly with the inspiration. Ibn Abbas moved his lips saying, 'I am moving my lips in front of you as Allah's Messenger used to move his.' Sa'id moved his lips saying, 'I am moving my lips as I saw Ibn Abbas moving his.' Ibn Abbas added, 'So Allah revealed, "Move not your tongue concerning the Quran to make haste therewith. It is for us to collect it and to give you the ability to recite it," which means that Allah will make him remember the portion of the Quran which was revealed at that time by heart and recite it. The statement of Allah, "And when we have recited it to you, then you follow its recital," means listen to it and be silent. "Then it is for us to make it clear to you," means then it is for Allah to make you recite it and its meaning will be clear by itself through your tongue. Afterwards, Allah's Messenger used to listen to Gabriel whenever he came, and after his departure, he used to recite it as Gabriel had recited it. Number 6. Narrated by Ibn Abbas. Allah's Messenger was the most generous of all people. He used to reach the peak in generosity in the month of Ramadan when Gabriel met him. Gabriel used to meet him every night of Ramadan to teach him the Quran. Allah's Messenger was the most generous person, even more generous than the strong, uncontrollable wind. Number 7. Narrated by Abdullah bin Abbas. Abu Sufyan bin Harb informed me that Heraclius had sent a messenger to him while he had been accompanying a caravan from Quraysh. There were merchants doing business in Sham at the time when Allah's Messenger had truce with Abu Sufyan and Quraysh infidels. So Abu Sufyan and his companions went to Heraclius at Ilia. Heraclius called them in the court and he had all the senior Roman dignitaries around him. He called for his translator who, translating Heraclius's question, said to them, "Who amongst you is closely related to that man who claims to be a prophet?" Abu Sufyan replied, "I am the nearest relative to him." Heraclius said, "Bring him close to me and make his companion stand behind him." Abu Sufyan added, "Heraclius told his translator to tell my companions that he wanted to put some questions to me regarding that man, and that if I told a lie, they should contradict me." Abu Sufyan added, "By Allah, had I not been afraid of my companions labeling me a liar, I would not have spoken the truth about the Prophet. The first question he asked me about him was, 'What is his family status amongst you?' I replied, 'He belongs to a good family amongst us.' Heraclius further asked, 'Has anybody amongst you ever claimed the same before him?' I replied, 'No.' He said, 'Was anybody amongst his ancestors a king?' I replied, 'No.' Heraclius asked, 'Do the nobles or the poor follow him?' I replied, 'It is the poor who follow him.' He said, 'Are his followers increasing, decreasing?' I replied, 'They are increasing.' He then asked, 'Does anybody amongst those who embrace his religion become displeased and renounce the religion afterwards?' I replied, 'No.' Heraclius said, 'Have you ever accused him of telling lies before his claim?' I replied, 'No.' Heraclius said, 'Does he break his promises?' I replied, 'No. We are at truce with him, but we do not know what he will do in it.' I could not find opportunity to say anything against him except that." Heraclius asked, "Have you ever had a war with him?" I replied, "Yes." Then he said, "What was the outcome of the battles?" I replied, "Sometimes he was victorious, and sometimes we." Heraclius said, "What does he order you to do?" I said, "He tells us to worship Allah and Allah alone, and not to worship anything along him, and to renounce all that our ancestors had said. He orders us to pray, to speak the truth, to be chaste, and to keep good relations with our kith and kin." Heraclius asked the translator to convey to me the following: "I asked you about his family, and your reply was that he belonged to a very noble family. In fact, all the apostles come from noble families amongst their respective peoples. I questioned you whether anybody else amongst you claimed such a thing. Your reply was in the negative. If the answer had been in the affirmative, I would have thought that this man was following the previous man's statement. Then I asked you whether any one of his ancestors was a king. Your reply was in the negative, and if it had been in the affirmative, I would have thought that this man wanted to take back his ancestral kingdom. I further asked whether he was accused of telling lies before he said what he said, and your reply was in the negative. So I wondered how a person who does not tell a lie about others could ever tell a lie about Allah. I then asked you whether the rich people followed him or the poor. You replied that it was the poor who followed him, and in fact, all the apostles have been followed by this very class of people. Then I asked you whether his followers were increasing or decreasing. You replied that they were increasing, and in fact, this is the way of true faith, till it is complete in all respects. I further asked you whether there was anybody who, after embracing his religion, became displeased and discarded his religion. Your reply was in the negative, and in fact, this is true faith, when its delight enters the heart and mixes with them completely. I asked you whether he had ever betrayed. You replied in the negative, and likewise, the apostles never betray. Then I asked you what he ordered you to do. You replied that he ordered you to worship Allah and Allah alone, and not to worship anything along with him, and forbade you to worship idols, and ordered you to pray, to speak the truth, and to be chaste. If what you have said is true, he will very soon occupy this place underneath my feet, and I knew it, that he was going to appear, but if I did not know that he would be from you, and if I could reach him definitely, I would go immediately to meet him if I were with him. I would certainly wash his feet. Heraclius then asked for the letters addressed by Allah's apostle, which was delivered by Dihya to the governor of Busra, who forwarded it to Heraclius to read. The contents of the letter were as follows. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. From Muhammad, the slave of Allah and his apostle, to Heraclius, the ruler of Byzantine. Peace be upon him who follows the right path. Furthermore, I invite you to Islam, and if you become a Muslim, you will be safe, and Allah will double your reward. And if you reject this invitation of Islam, you will be committing a sin of Erisiyin. And, O people of the scripture, come to a word common to you and us that we worship none but Allah, and that we associate nothing in worship with him, and that none of us shall take others as lords besides Allah. Then, if they turn away, say, bear witness that we are Muslims. Abu Sufyan then added, when Heraclius had finished his speech and had read the letter, there was a great hue and cry in the royal court. So we were turned out of the court. I told my companions that the question of Ibn Abi Kabsha has become so prominent that even the king of Bani al-Asfar is afraid of him. Then I started to become sure that he would be the conqueror in the near future till I embraced Islam. The sub-narrator adds, Ibn al-Natur was the governor of Ilia, and Heraclius was the head of the Christians of Sham. Ibn al-Natur narrates that once, while Heraclius was visiting Ilia, he got up in the morning with a sad mood. Some of his priests asked him why he was in that mood. Heraclius was a foreteller and an astrologer. He replied, at night, when I looked at the stars, I saw that the leader of those who practice circumcision had appeared. Who are they who practice circumcision? The people replied, except the Jews, nobody practices circumcision, so you should not be afraid. Just issue orders to kill every Jew present in the country. While they were discussing it, a messenger sent by the king of Ghassan to convey the news of Allah's messenger to Heraclius was brought in. Having heard the news, he ordered the people to go and see whether the messenger of Ghassan was circumcised. The people, after seeing him, told Heraclius that he was circumcised. Heraclius then asked him about the Arabs. The messenger replied, Arabs also practice circumcision. After hearing that, Heraclius remarked that sovereignty of the Arabs had appeared. Heraclius then wrote a letter to his friend in Rome, who was as good as Heraclius in knowledge. Heraclius then left for Homs and stayed there till he received the reply of his letter from his friend, who agreed with him in his opinion about the emergence of the prophet and the fact that he was a prophet. On that, Heraclius invited all the heads of Byzantines to assemble in his palace at Homs. When they assembled, he ordered that all the doors of his palace be closed. Then he came out and said, O Byzantines, if success is your desire, and if you seek right guidance and want your empire to remain, then give a pledge of allegiance to this prophet. On hearing the views of Heraclius, the people ran towards the gates of the palace like onagers, but found the door closed. Heraclius realized their hatred towards Islam, and when he lost the hope of their embracing Islam, he ordered that they should be brought back in audience. When they returned, he said, What already said was just to test the strength of your conviction, and I have seen it. The people prostrated before him and became pleased with him, and this was the end of Heraclius' story. Thank you so much for listening. If you genuinely enjoyed this audiobook and would like us to make more, simply hit the like and subscribe button.